Welcome back to After the Fact. I'm Christian Esguerra. We're now joined by Major General Romeo Bronner Jr., the new Commanding General of the Philippine Army. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us at the program. Congratulations on your new appointment.
Thank you, Christian, and good evening to our televiewers.
Okay, let's talk about your priorities for the Philippine Army, given the challenges that we're facing now in terms of insurgency, in terms of violent extremism. What will be the priorities for you?
Well, the Philippine Army is basically a force provider, Christian. It means that the job of the Philippine Army is to recruit soldiers, train them, equip them, and then sustain them as they fight in the front lines. So as a force provider, the first thrust that I want to accomplish during my incumbency as the commanding general of the Philippine Army is to look after the welfare of the soldier and his family. So we are going to make sure that our soldiers are healthy, they are well-fed, and well-trained. No? And this will also include, of course, their families. No? We will have to look after the welfare of their families. So we are going to strengthen our medical system, which will also include the mental health of our soldiers. Second, Christian, is that we are going to make our soldiers more competent, more skillful, and more professional. No? And then third is that we will enable our army units to fight any war by pushing down the resources, no, like human resources, financial resources, and logistical resources. So these are my three priorities, Christian.
How about compensation?
Well,
are they properly compensated as things stand now?
Well, it was during the incumbency of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte that the salary and incentives of the soldiers have been increased. No? So, you know what, Christian? The entry level of a soldier, no, the pay for the entry level is 40,000 pesos. So if you compare that to the other professions, talagang lamang na lamang ang mga sundalo natin.
Can this be sustained in terms of retirement benefits?
Well, right now, there is a pending bill in Congress where they're trying to restructure the pension system of the soldiers. Right now, the pension of our retirees increase as the salaries of the regular force, the soldiers in the regular force increases. So somehow, the government finds it difficult to sustain that kind of pension system.
Yeah, that is the concern, because the pension system, there were fears before that the system might collapse because of the benefits that they are well-deservedly receiving now, right? So dapat planuhin yung future.
That's right, Christian. So there are a lot of schemes now that are coming out, but we're still waiting for the final version of that law.
Okay. Let's talk about the campaign against the communist insurgency. There were commitments and promises made before that the communist insurgency would be extinguished or defeated by 2022. Is that something that can still be achieved?
It was the president himself, Christian, who gave us that target, no? To finish the local communist armed conflict by the end of his term. So that is June 2022. Right now, with the rate of the campaign that we have launched, we believe that we will achieve great strides towards that objective. You know? We may not be able to eliminate totally this problem of the communist armed conflict by June 2022, but definitely, you know, there is a downtrend in the number of NPA fighters, in the number of arms, in the number of guerrilla fronts, and in the number of barangays that they control. So we believe, Christian, that we have reached already that tipping point or the crossover point wherein the rate of the neutralization of the NPA fighters is higher than the rate of their recruitment of new fighters.
In terms of numbers, what are we looking at here? Because there must be some measurable targets, right?
That's
if
right.
If you say great strides or end the local communist armed conflict.
So,
for instance, how big is the communist movement, the NPA? How big is it now?
Wow. Okay, Christian, let's go back a few years back. The peak of the numbers of the NPA reached 25,000 in the early 90s, no, late 80s, early 90s. But right now, they are down to 3,000 only, no, nationwide. So, in the number of guerrilla fronts also, Christian, this is how we measure how we are successful in our campaign. And right now, there has been an upsurge in the number of guerrilla fronts that we are clearing. Because of this trend, we are now seeing more and more members of the New People's Army surrendering to the government. No? And this is the real objective that we want to achieve, that we end this local communist armed conflict without firing a shot, without killing a fellow Filipino.
So by the time the term of President Duterte ends, what's your target in terms of numbers, let's say, of the guerrilla fronts and the warm bodies belonging to the New People's Army? Kung sa ngayon, nasa 3,000, right?
Well, we haven't really set that target, Christian. Medyo ambitious masyado yung ating targets. Definitely, we want all the 3,000 to be neutralized. No? When we say neutralized, it doesn't mean that they have to be killed. They can either surrender or we capture them, no? Or we rescue the minors. So it's very ambitious, really. All the 3,000, no? And all the guerrilla fronts. So that's our target, Christian. But naniniwala kasi tayo, if we aim high, and then we fall short of our target, at least we're already up there.
Okay, but in the first place, can you actually defeat this communist insurgency mainly through a military approach? For instance, in terms of eliminating or neutralizing the actual members of the New People's Army, is that even feasible?
You know, Christian, we learned it the hard way. No, at first we all thought that the solution to this problem is a military solution. But right now, not recently, but a few years back, we started to realize that the solution to end this communist armed conflict is really to deliver the basic services to our people. Even those in the farthest, the remotest barangays. No? So that is why, Christian, the Executive Order Number 70 that President Duterte signed into law is, for me, the best thing that happened to our fight against this communist armed conflict. Because with this, no, it established the NTF-LCAC, and with the NTF-LCAC, the primary principle behind this is the whole of nation approach, meaning everybody helping in, contributing to finally end this local communist armed conflict.
But there are those who are pushing for the abolition of the NTF-LCAC because of different reasons, one of which was the supposed duplication of the responsibilities of existing agencies. Sinasabi na iba, parang nagtayo na super layer that basically does the job of the other agencies and putting power within the hands of a select few. How do you respond to these concerns?
I disagree with this, Christian, because I agree that each agency has their own mandate, but we need this collective organization that would really direct the efforts of each of these agencies, each of these local government units, non-government organizations, even the private sector. No? So there has to be an umbrella organization that would really, you know, synergize all the efforts of all of these sectors of society.
How about the concern that the NTF-ELCAP was also used to justify the red baiting of enemies, political enemies of the existing administration, not just real communist insurgents?
Well, that's very sad, really, Christian, no? People are saying that the NTF-ELCAP was used for other objectives other than what it was really meant for. But if you really look at the principle of the NTF-ELCAP, it's really, you know, everybody joining hands and working together towards one common goal.
By the way, you under your command, George Kaoris Matlos was neutralized, right?
Yes.
Back in October. How big was the impact of that of his killing as far as your campaign against the communist insurgency?
Well, first, let's look into who George Matlos or Kaoris. He started actually here in Mindanao, no, 5 decades ago. They were the original members of the Communist Party of the Philippines, and just before he was killed, he was already the commander of the National Organization Command of the New People's Army. Meaning, no, he was the highest in command, and he was also
calling the shots.
Yes, if you compare it to the Armed Forces of the Philippines, he was the chief of staff, no, of the New People's Army. So with his death, we believe that this is the start of the downfall, no, of the New People's Army. In fact, after he died, no, we have seen an influx of surrenderees nationwide, no, not just here in northern Mindanao, but nationwide. A lot of them were demoralized. When we asked them why they surrendered, no, a lot of them were demoralized because they looked up to George Matlos. He was the only one holding these forces together. So, unti-unti, Christian, we are seeing this trend nationwide. No? A lot of surrenderees bringing with them their firearms. So, talagang we believe that very soon, I hope so, that we will reach the target of really ending the local communist armed conflict.
And speaking of Kaoris, how instrumental was he in terms of holding resources for the New People's Army, including financial resources?
Yes, we believe that the reason why he based himself here in northern Mindanao was because this is where they get the biggest portion of their resources. No, we believe that 1/3 of the resources that they extort from private companies here in the area of northern Mindanao, they get it primarily from mining companies, no? Contractors, from logging companies, farmers, no? Even the ordinary citizens ay kinokotongan nila, even the politicians, especially now, Christian, that we are moving towards an election year, no? We have had reports already of extortion attempts by the New People's Army in the guise of permit to campaign and permit to win. No?
Yeah. Speaking of the election campaign, that's a common problem or issue during election campaigns. The extortion activities by the New People's Army, of course, they would say, permit to campaign, no? So, in support of the movement. Usually, the Philippine National Police promises that they would deal with that concern. But we know the limitations by the Philippine National Police. But on the part of the Philippine Army, what are the concrete steps that you're going to take during the election campaign to make sure that election campaigns would proceed quite smoothly and areas under the influence, if not control, of the New People's Army?
Well, specifically here at the 4th Infantry Division, Christian, we already organized the Task Force HOPE. No? HOPE stands for Honest, Orderly, Peaceful Elections. Usually, we establish this towards the election day, no? Maybe a month before the election day. But this time, we established it very early. No? So that we want to give a strong message to our candidates, no? That they do not have to pay this permit to campaign or permit to win to the New People's Army. We promise them that when they want to campaign, for instance, in a remote barangay, they just inform us. No, we will not give them individual security, but we will secure the place. No? Area security is what we will provide to the candidates so that they can go in, freely campaign, and then leave the area safely.
But they have enough soldiers to actually do that in those areas that where those permits to campaign might be used as leverage by the new People's Army.
What we are asking the candidates, Christian, is for them to schedule, give us a definite schedule, you know, so that we will bring forces into that area and we will secure them as they do their campaigning.
Okay. Now, speaking again of the NTF-LCAC, the proposed budget was drastically reduced at the Senate. We don't know yet how much would the final budget for the NTF-LCAC for 2022 would be. But what if, let's say, the budget is indeed drastically reduced? How would that affect your campaign against the communist insurgency? And number two, part of the discussion so far during the campaign is the abolition of the NTF-LCAC. What if the next president ends up abolishing the NTF-LCAC? How would that affect your campaign?
Yes. To your first question, Christian, you know what, the Barangay Development Program, the BDP, no, is actually the biggest portion of the pie when it comes to the budget of the NTF-LCAC. Now, the BDP is the budget that goes down to the barangay. No? In fact, the barangay receives 20 million pesos for specific programs. For instance, farm-to-market roads, medical clinics, schools, water systems, electrical systems, and so on. Anything that the barangay actually needs, no? Because this is the source of the issues that are exploited by the New People's Army. So if the government can deliver the basic services to these areas, no, through the BDP, through the 20 million pesos, then we can say that really the New People's Army will not be able to recruit anymore from these areas, no, because the issues have been addressed. So really this BDP funding is very important, especially next year. Marami tayong mga barangays that were programmed for the BDP. In case the next administration will eradicate, let's say, NTF-LCAC and the BDP, perhaps what we can do is really to still draw the different resources from our government agencies and from the local government units, no? Because next year, the funding of the LGUs will be increased. So perhaps we can tap from these resources so that we can bring it into these barangays. It's not just about the money, Christian. What's important is everybody working together to address the issues and deliver the basic services.
By the way, were you part of that security briefing with Vice President Len Robredo, where afterward she said she would perhaps retain the good facets or aspects of the NTF-LCAC? Which I also drew criticisms toward her, right? Oh. Were you part of that security briefing?
I wasn't in the same room, Christian, but we saw the briefing itself. And really, if you see the briefing, you will be enlightened as to what is actually the NTF-LCAC and the gains that we have already accomplished because of the BDP that we are bringing down, you know, the projects that we are bringing down to the different barangays.
So is it safe to say that somehow that presentation clarified a lot of things for the Vice President?
Yes, I can say that, Christian, because really there are a lot of misconceptions about the NTF-LCAC. No, but if you really try to understand what it is, the purpose of the NTF-LCAC and the Barangay Development Program, then you will see that really, para sa mga taong bayan ito, para sa mga mahihirap na komunidad itong BDP.
But during the Senate budget deliberations, this was raised by Senator Sonny Angara, out of the 2,318 projects, only 26 were completed. And even the number 2,318 That was quite mind-boggling. No? Ganong karaming projects. I mean, do you have any idea what were the nature of these projects?
I don't really know the nature of these projects, Christian. But they are of that nature. No, mga barangay, farm-to-market roads, water system, medical clinics, and so on. You know what? We believe, and we saw here on the ground, no, the difficulty of implementing these projects. No, nabulunan yung mga local government units natin because they are the ones who are implementing this. No, the implementation is at the provincial level, although the beneficiaries are the barangays, but it is at the provincial level. Imagine if you have, let's say in one province you have 50. No, barangays that are beneficiaries of this. So, just imagine the amount that you have to obligate. No?
Before a barangay receives a development fund, it has to be cleared first, right?
That's right.
That correct.
So there is.
When you say cleared, what do you mean?
We mean that it is cleared of influence from the NPAs, Christian.
And how would you know?
So we have a set of parameters, no, that will determine whether a barangay is cleared or not.
Can you set an example? For example, adherence. Diba, minsan mga bahay-bahay dyan, adherence to the New People's Army. Sometimes you cannot blame them, diba? Because they're thinking, baka yung justice na hindi ko makuha through the proper channels, baka makuha ko pag lumapit ako sa NPA. We know these things are happening in some of the remote areas, right? So what do you mean by clearing?
Well, of course, it means that there is no presence of any NPAs already in the barangay. That the people's organizations that were organized by the CPP, NPA, NDF have been co-opted, meaning they are already not leaning towards the CPP, NPA, NDF, but they are within the system of government already, no?
Okay.
So these are some of the parameters that we use, Christian. Okay.
We have a few minutes left. I'd like to ask you about the anti-terrorism law. The Supreme Court has already decided, but we don't know the decision yet. I think they're still clarifying certain votes when it comes to certain provisions. But let's talk about the impact. How important this anti-terrorism law for you, for the Philippine Army? Not just in your campaign against the local communist armed conflict, the communist insurgency, but also divided extremists.
Yes, it's very important that we have a law so that we can bring to justice, to our justice system, these people who really want to bring chaos and harm to our people. No, so kailangan natin ng ngipin, Christian. And one of the sub components of that law is the anti-terrorism financing law, no, which means that any organization or any individual who is proven to be supporting the CPP, NPA, NDF or any terrorist organizations are also liable under the law.
No, but one concern, I think, is the vagueness of the definition, for instance, of terrorism, and also the idea that you have an anti-terrorism council, which is very powerful. We understand the concerns in terms of prosecuting and going after, for example, violent extremists. But again, there are certain loopholes that have been pointed to by those who are petitioning against the anti-terrorism law. So, and you, as an implementer, no? You're commanding the army that is fighting the violent extremists and the communist insurgents. How would you respond to such concerns?
You know what, Christian, even if there are flaws in that law, you know, but when it comes to the implementation on the ground, your soldier, your Filipino soldier, is very professional. You know? We are schooled in the international humanitarian law. We know our rules of engagement. We know our rule of law. So even if people are worried, no, that this law can be abused, no, by the Philippine Army or by the armed forces of the Philippines, they can rest assured that they will not. This will not be abused by your armed forces.
Major General Romeo Browner Jr., the new commanding general of the Philippine Army, thank you for joining us tonight on the program. Thank you for answering our questions.
Thank you, Christian, and more power to you.
So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now, for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.